yesterday. We ended class in the middle of our discussion of propagators. So I'd just like to finish that up before we begin talking about the LSE reduction formula. Okay, so we left off with the retarded propagator, which we had two expressions for it. One was this theta function of x minus y times the expectation value of the commutator of x with y. And we derived the second expression in terms of a contour integral. Okay, and this contour here was in the complex P0 plane. So our integrand had two poles at plus EP and minus EP. And this retarded propagator went around the poles in the positive imaginary part. So these two poles are where this I over P squared minus M squared vanish. And we saw that this integral gave us this commutator when we closed the contour in the with the negative imaginary part of P0, then we picked up both of the poles. Alternatively, so that was when x0 was greater than y0. Now this should be x0 and y0. And if x0 is greater, x0 is less than y0, then we should close the pole. Close the contour in the upper half plane in order for the additional part of the contour not to contribute. And that means we won't get either of the poles, and so we'll just get 0. So that's that was how we argued that these two expressions were equivalent. We also showed that this propagator was a Green's function for the Klein-Gordon operator. That is, we showed that partial squared plus m squared acting on delta r gave us I delta of x minus y. And there's a minus sign here. And in deriving this, we didn't have to use the contour anywhere. So in particular, we can construct other Green's functions where we have a different prescription for going around these poles. And those will also be Green's functions of the Klein-Gordon operator. So, what's the difference between these different pole prescriptions? So this Green's function vanishes when x0 is less than y0, which means we can use it to solve the inhomogeneous Klein-Gordon equation with a classical source. So the delta r, the retarded propagator, is the correct Green's function to use to solve this equation if we want to impose boundary conditions at some fixed time t and then ask what's the future evolution of the field. So we can use delta R to solve the inhomogeneous Klein-Gordon equation when we impose boundary conditions at a fixed t and ask about future evolution. Yes.
Is J just a function of space?
Or in general space time? Space time, sure. This should be in general. Okay. So if we choose the opposite prescription for going around the poles, we can define an advanced Green function. So we can define delta A of x minus y to be the same thing, just with the argument of the theta function switched. And so all we're doing is switching the role of x and y. So the contour associated with this Green's function should just be the opposite one, where we pick up the contribution from the poles only when y naught is greater than x naught, and we should get 0 when x naught is greater than y naught. So it's the same argument we made before, and we can use this advanced Green's function to solve this inhomogeneous Klein-Gordon equation in the same way if we want to impose boundary conditions at some future time and ask where the field, how can you evolve to some future boundary condition.
Sorry, Dan, you need to know what the bracket is going
to be. Thanks. Okay. So these are two possibilities. These are two Green's functions of the same operator. But we could also go around the poles in two other ways. We could go above this pole at minus EP and below the one at plus EP, or the reverse. And doing something like that is going to turn out to be the most useful for us. And we'll see why a bit later in the lecture. But let's first just write down the Green's function associated with going around one of the poles below this pole and above this pole. So this is what I'll call the Feynman contour. And this is the Feynman propagator. And so we're just going to, so here we'll, no matter whether x naught is greater than y naught or x naught is less than y naught, we'll always pick up the contribution from one of these poles. So this is never 0, no matter which way we have to close the contour. And so what we'll get is theta x naught minus y naught. So if x naught is greater than y naught, we get 5x, 5y. And in the reverse case, we get y naught minus x naught, 5y, 5x, which we can write in a more compact way as just 0 times the time ordering of phi of x, phi of y. And so this is a new symbol that we'll run into again midway through today's lecture. That means it's called the time ordering symbol. And it means put the latest operator to the left. And the second latest, if there's more than two, the second latest next to the left. So this just is a shorthand notation for this. So this we use this expression if x occurs after y, and this expression if y occurs after x. And if we have multiple more than two phis here, we would just put them in order from the last one to the first one, from left to right. Okay. So we'll see this come up in the middle of this lecture. We'll come back to this and see why it's important. But any questions here before we move on to the LSE reduction formula? The fourth one would just be, so we'd go around in the opposite way and would anti-time order them. It doesn't really have any, it's closely related to this one, so you just get some minus signs here and there. But it's not, so you use retarded and advanced propagators all the time in classical electrodynamics. This one is the important one for quantum field theory. The anti-Feynman propagator, I guess, doesn't really have that many uses.
So these are the Green's functions of the Klein-Gordon equation.
That's right.
Why do we call them propagators? And like,
so this, if we look at this expression, if we didn't have this time ordering here, this would just be the amplitude for a particle to propagate from y to x. So if we think of, because these are real fields, so this part here is the state with a particle at y, and this part here would be the particle at x.
Okay. Yes.
So they're all they're all Green functions in the same way.
They're all Green's functions. Yes, they all satisfy the bottom equation on the top board up there. So if I put instead of subscript R A or F, the same equation would hold.
So I guess that's a hyperbolic equation, and it has an infinite number of solutions because of the nature, the fact that space-time has indefinite signature. If you go to Euclidean space, that will have a unique solution.
Right, because you could combine those propagators in like a sum.
Okay, so the remainder of the lecture, we'll discuss the LSZ reduction formula. So this stands for Lehman, Szymanczyk, and Zimmermann, who first came up with it. And it's going to be one of the key formulas that allow us to compute quantities related to scattering in quantum field theory. So the type of process we'll be interested in for the next several lectures is we have some number of particles going in, colliding, and then coming out. So some incoming particles, a collision, and outgoing particles. And the question we'll be asking in this lecture and the next few lectures is, if we say that the incoming particles are in some state I and the outgoing particles are in some state F, how can we compute the amplitude to go from I to F? So this is what we'll be trying to compute. And next week, we'll see how to relate this to physically measurable things like cross sections and decay rates. OK. So the first question we can ask are, what kind of states do we want to consider? So we want to consider states where we have incoming particles and outgoing particles. But how do we describe that mathematically? So we saw in yesterday's lecture that in the Klein-Gordon, the free Klein-Gordon theory, particles number is conserved. So we know how to describe the particle states in the free theory, but we'll need to generalize that a bit to the interacting theory. And need to think carefully about what assumptions we need our interacting theory to satisfy in order for what we've learned about the free theory to apply to processes like this, where particle number may or may not be conserved. But in general, we don't have any interesting scattering of this type in the free theory. So we need to generalize beyond what we did yesterday. But let's start by recalling what we learned about the free theory yesterday. So we know that in the free theory, namely the Klein-Gordon theory, are one particle states called K, are given by a dagger 0, acting on 0, where all of the annihilation operators annihilate the vacuum. The vacuum is normalized. And the overlap between this state with momentum k and with k prime is 2 pi cubed 2 ek delta k minus k prime. Okay. So these are momentum eigenstates, as you saw in tutorial yesterday. So if we're interested in scattering, it'll be useful to define, instead of momentum eigenstates, wave packets that are created out of these momentum eigenstates. So what we want is to create a wave packet where things are localized in momentum space and also somewhat localized in position space. So we can imagine that a collision, say, occurs at t equals 0 near the origin. Of course, we can't say it occurs exactly at t equals 0, exactly at the origin, but we want to sort of localize the collision by creating wave packets. So let's do that. And let's define an operator, A1 dagger, which is just some integral over d3k f1 of k times a k dagger. And we want this to create a one particle state. That is localized in momentum space. Near, let's say, K1. So this one here identifies which particular momentum this particle's momentum is localized around. And we also want this to be localized in position space. Near the origin. So we have in mind that F1 takes the form, the precise form is not going to be important, but something like an exponential of minus k minus k1 squared divided by some width in momentum space. Okay, and so yeah, we want it to be localized in position space near the origin at t equals 0. Okay. So if we evolve this state, A1 dagger k, depending on the origin, what will happen is it will spread out. And so that means that if we look at the two particle state, A1 dagger, A2 dagger, acting on 0, where K1 is not equal to K2, and we look at this state in the far past, this describes two particles that are widely separated. So if the wave packets are centered on different momenta, if we go far enough back, they'll be arbitrarily the place where we're likely to find the two particles is likely to be very large. The difference between where we're likely to find them. And by construction, they come together and interact at the origin near t equals 0. Okay. Yes? Explain. So if we evolve this state in the Schrodinger picture, so this is localized near the origin at t equals 0. That's how we constructed it. Just by assumption. If we involve it either forward or backwards in time, it's going to become less and less localized in position space because there's some spread in momentum. So this is a one particle state. Okay. This is a two particle state. Oh. So we're just acting with two operators of the same form, except they're centered on different momenta. Different momentum here, so we're assuming that. Yes?
So the wave packet is spreading out as we advance forward in time.
Yes.
In spatial.
Yes, also if we evolve backwards in time.
And it will spread out if we evolve backwards.
Either
so the interpretation of a particle being infinitely spread out is that they're infinitely far apart.
Oh, well, we could ask what's the. Say mean distance between the two particles as we go arbitrarily far in the future or arbitrarily far in the past. So that would have a well-defined answer, even if we couldn't say where either particle is.
And you talk about spread out in terms of distance and not in momentum. Like how different their momenta are?
Right. So when I'm saying spread out, I mean in position space. So We want to try to do the same.
How do we evolve this state in time? Like, is that just the Schrodinger equation?
That's just the Schrodinger equation. Okay. Alternatively, so.
I made the statement about this, how the state evolves in the Schrodinger picture. We could, as we'll do shortly, switch to the Heisenberg picture, and these operators will evolve in time too. That's right. Yeah. So H, we deduced. Well, I told you what H is yesterday, and you'll compute that in tutorial tomorrow. But remember, we were treating time and space differently. So using the canonical quantization picture, they play different roles, even though the theory is Lorentz invariant. Okay. So we want to try to do the same thing in an interacting theory. Okay, so I'm not going to make any assumptions about the form of the interactions or the form the interactions take. I'm just going to restrict our attention to scalars. So we'll just be looking at spin zero bosons. But other than that, the interactions could take an arbitrary form. So we're not going to make any assumptions about what those look like. And see how far we can get just by making general statements. So what is going to change if we go to an interacting theory? So one thing that will change is the vacuum. So we don't know that the vacuum state, if we change our Lagrangian and hence change our Hamiltonian, will be the same as it was as the vacuum we looked at before. We'll discuss more about what the interacting vacuum looks like tomorrow, but it's in general going to be different in an interacting theory than in a free theory. So that's one change, and I'll denote the interacting vacuum by this omega. And it's going to be convenient here to let's switch to the Heisenberg picture. So we'll move all of our time dependence into the operators. So what assumptions do we want to make? So let's make the assumption that these operators still create one particle states even in the interacting theory. So that's an assumption, and we'll come back to that at the end of the lecture and see and check that assumption and see whether that's reasonable. Yes?
When you said on the board about the A1 represents when you act in vacuum, you get something localized in
position space. Is that meant to be taken literally in the sense of quantum mechanics as we know it, where it represents the probabilities of finding the particle at different positions?
Yeah. So that's what I mean. So where you're likely to find it, or the spread in where you're likely to find it, will evolve in time. But at t equals zero, you're likely to find it in a relatively small, or I'm not defining what small means, a region around the origin, just because we want these particles to interact, come together at the origin.
So we'll switch to the Heisenberg picture.
We want to assume, make the assumption that these create one particle states. In the interacting theory. Why? So the case we're going to be most interested in tomorrow when we look at particular forms of the interaction and on Friday and pretty much the rest of the course is where the interactions are in some sense small, so we can treat them as a perturbation. So if they're a perturbation, we expect we're not changing the free theory a whole lot. So as we'll do today and really in the rest of the week, we're going to relate our interacting theory to our free theory by treating the interactions as just a small perturbation. Yes?
Hamilton commutes with your number operators of your integration operators. Those states are number states. And problems that way, right?
Our free Hamiltonian will commute with the number operator. Once we include interactions, that will in general no longer be true. So just for ease of notation, I'm going to look at the 2-to-2 scattering case. And the fact that we'll just consider 2-to-2 scattering is not going to play a key role. It will just unclutter the notation a little bit.
Faster than the speed of light because the wave function collapses to a space-like separate point.
Well, we saw that. So our theory is causal, right? We saw that our measurements will never affect anything outside the light cone.
It's problematic to think of that as an actual wave function. Or in what sense is it not a wave function if you can't just measure it and have it collapse infinitely far away? Not infinitely, but
far away.
So how do you calculate the probability of finding a particle at position x or in the neighborhood of x? Is it just?
So we wanted to.
So we can know that this is so that we know that this state is doing what we want it to do.
Right. Like, so if we want to. So this is not a. So we can construct the position operator. And we could find out what's the expectation value of the position operator or the expectation value of the position minus the variance in the position. So we can construct an operator and act on the state we have and then calculate the expectation value.
And then pi x acting on 0 is an eigenstate of the position operator.
I'm failing to see where this is different than quantum mechanics that I've seen before, because other than the fact that we have to act on the vector to create a particle, then it seems like we have a wave function and all of the problems with that have come back.
So what
I think this is related to what Dan is asking, but
okay.
I'm not sure.
So I don't think there's a collapse of the wave function. Mm-hmm. We're not interested in that because what we want at the end of the day is to have to create, calculate an amplitude, and then that amplitude will actually give us the observable probability that we're interested in, and then all the collapse happens. But in this whole process of these particles coming in from asymptopia, interacting, going away to asymptopia, it's like completely unitary evolution, right?
Yeah.
At the experimental setup that we're interested in is that, right? And then, it collapses or whatever.
Jan, are you going to go through anything on sources and detectors?
Sources and detectors, I wasn't planning on
right.
It's a theoretical.
Well, no, like this is probably best answer to Dan's questions, but I mean, you can set up like a detector as something that kind of couples your field to like a position, degree of freedom that's stuck at a position. And then if you have a wave function that's like spread over space, then you get a click, and you've got a probability of getting a click over, like if you go over a certain time period. But when you get that click, it's not like you're sending information far, like you don't use that sending information far like in space to have, you know, like suddenly you're not getting a click somewhere else, right? Like there's only ever a finite probability at another position far away of getting a click somewhere else. And like if they don't see something, it's not like they know you've observed it.
I'm happy to talk about it later, but I would argue that if it's an actual position wave function, you could send information faster than light. But
we'll have to debate this.
Okay. So we'll restrict our attention to the 2-to-2 scattering case, and so that means we'll consider our initial state to be the limit as t goes to minus infinity of a1 dagger of t, a2 dagger of t, acting in the vacuum. And we'll choose our normalization so ii is equal to 1. And we can define choose our final state to be the same thing, except it's the limit as t goes to plus infinity, a3 dagger t, a4 dagger of t, omega. And choose the same normalization here.
That's a very good question, and I will come back to that later. Yes.
Why is it, why do we keep, like, assume that the vacuum might be different, but, I mean, we are assuming that we are creating, A1 dagger creates one particle states, mm-hmm. because we are, like, saying the interaction is very small and we are perturbing it, but we are assuming that we have a different vacuum. What's the...
Yes, the vacuum is different.
Why? So, we'll define our vacuum to be the state with no particles or the lowest energy state. So, if we change our Hamiltonian, we're changing what we mean by the lowest energy state. So, in general, we will change what we mean by the vacuum. There's a sense in which these are close. And tomorrow, I'll derive a precise relationship between these two.
Take zero vacuum time.
We'll go into that tomorrow.
So is the vacuum still defined as the state that is such that if you act with any lowering operator on it, it's zero? Give zero? Or?
Yes, we'll define it that way. But that's
still holds.
Yeah, that's an assumption at this point. Okay. So our goal is to compute this thing. And to do that, there's a useful identity. And that identity is that a1 dagger of plus infinity equals minus a1 dagger of minus infinity is equal to the integral from minus infinity to infinity dt partial 0 of a1 dagger of t. And if we make another assumption, that AK dagger is still related to phi in the same way as for the free field. As you derived in tutorial, that means that AK dagger is equal to minus I integral d3x e to the minus I k x partial 0 5x plus I e k. So we'll assume that this still holds, even in the interacting theory. We can plug that in here. And after some manipulation that you'll do in tutorial tomorrow, we get that this is equal to minus I integral d3k f1 of k integral d4k e to the minus I k dot x partial squared plus m squared 5x. And I'll denote this enormous thing as I dagger 1. So this just some algebra and integration by parts here. You'll do it tomorrow. So here we have d squared plus m squared, the Klein-Gordon operator acting on the field. This would be 0 in the free theory, which tells us that these one particle operators don't evolve in time, are the same in plus and minus infinity. But in general, if we have an interacting theory, this is non-zero. And if we do the same thing, we can compute the relationship between A1 at plus infinity, which is just equal to A1 at minus infinity, plus I1. So we just take the complex conjugate, and we get a change the sign here and change the sign here. That's what I mean by I1. Okay. So with those assumptions, we can actually get quite far. So if we just use this identity, and let's plug it into our formula for the amplitude to go from I to F, and see what we get.
The infinities are in space-time, or?
So these are, so A1 dagger and A1 depend on time. Yeah. Okay, so we know that Fi is equal to omega A4 of plus infinity, A3 of plus infinity, 1 of minus infinity, A2 of minus infinity, acting on omega.
Daggers on the velocity.
Sorry?
Daggers on the velocity.
Thank you. Okay. So, trivial observation. These operators are already time ordered. So we can insert the time ordering operator we saw, time ordering symbol we saw at the beginning of lecture in here without changing anything. So let's do that. So now we can use the useful identity and relate A4 at plus infinity to A4 at minus infinity, and similarly for the other three terms. And if we do that, what we get is I won't write out all of the terms, but I'll just write out a few to see what's happening. We get one term in which there are no i's. So we get a4 of minus infinity, a3 of minus infinity, a1 dagger of plus infinity, a2 dagger of plus infinity, omega. A bunch of terms that contain both A's and I's, which I won't write out, and also a term that only contains I's. So I4, I3, minus I1 dagger, minus I2, times minus I2 dagger. Okay. So let's think about what we have here. So first of all, we notice that this term, after we time order, A3 and A4 will be brought to the right, where they annihilate the vacuum. So we're still assuming that the A's annihilate the vacuum. So after we bring things through, this term is 0. And the same argument works here, because these are at plus and minus infinity, and our expressions for I just have finite values of x. The earliest thing is always these annihilation operators, A4 and A3. And the latest thing is always these creation operators, A1 dagger and A2 dagger. So all these terms are 0, too. So we're just left with this expression that involves all these integrals.
And I'm sorry, can you say the argument again that the terms you didn't write are 0?
OK, so we can look at some of them. So one example might have, I won't write out everything, but it might have an A4 of minus infinity and, say, an I3. Something else, well, A1 dagger plus infinity, A2 dagger plus infinity. So a term like this. Okay. And it's time ordered.
Right.
So
0 for the same reason.
This is always the earliest thing. Mm-hmm. And these are always the latest operators. Yeah, so I's are, well, there's operators in the I's, but they're evaluated at finite values of x, at finite times. Okay. So that was the main reason we needed to put wave packets in there, so that we could get rid of these terms, so that the A3s and A4s were always the earliest things after we use this identity. So we can now take the limit that f1 of k1, k, it's a, and similarly for the other one, f2 and f3 and f4, become delta functions. And that means that, say, minus I1 dagger becomes plus I integral d4 x1 e to the minus I k1 dot x1 partial squared plus m squared on 5x. So there are operators in the eyes, but they're all the operators are evaluated at finite times. So the earliest operators, so the things that go to the right in the time ordering, are always the, if there's an A3 or an A4, it's always the rightmost thing. So it announces the vacuum. If there's no A3 or A4, there will always be in either an A1 dagger or an A2 dagger in the dot, dot, dot terms I left out. And those are always the latest thing, so they always come to the right. So they always annihilate the vacuum on the left. Yes?
Where does the f going to delta come from?
So it just simplifies our final formula. It's not important for, yeah. Okay. We can just take the limit. So we're really are interested in the case where these are approximately momentum eigenstates. We calculate scattering. It's much harder if we think of things in terms of wave packets. So we want them to be as close to momentum eigenstates as we can.
But we also assume that at t equals 0, they are almost position eigenstates, right? They're localized at the origin. How can we have both?
Well, they have an infinitely long time to spread out, right? So what's important is that they just interact in some way, right? So that's they just need to. There needs to be some, at some time, they need to be close to each other, right? That's all we really need. And if they are, it wasn't crucial to our argument that the interaction occurred near the origin. We just need them to interact in some way. So what we're really interested in is the sending in two particles that are approximately definite momenta, and asking what do we get out afterwards. So the time scales associated with interactions are generally very, very short, 10 to the minus a large number of seconds. So in colliders, where we're colliding these particles, it's if the particles travel a few meters to reach the detection, that takes a very long time compared to the time scale of the interaction. So this approximation where we're taking our asymptotic states is a reasonable approximation to real experiments. And we usually don't know or care where the interaction occurred. Right? So we just measure. We know the statistics of what are colliding in the accelerator, and we measure what comes out. We don't see the collision actually occurring. So we're not doing any measurements in between. We're just measuring, or we have some information about the initial state, and we measure the final state. Okay. So let's put that together. What we have. So this result is known as the LSZ reduction formula. And I'll just put together our results. So this last term is the only one that contributes. And so let me just write out what the i's are after we've taken this limit that the f's become delta functions. So what we get is that f I is equal to, I'm going to write this in a form that generalizes more easily to the case where we have n particles scattering into m particles. So we assumed there was 2 to 2, but that's not a key assumption. So we had one factor of I for each of the big I's up there. So 2 from the initial, 2 from the final. And we have a product over all of the particles. Integral d4 xj times e to the minus I lambda j xj dot, right, it's kj dot xj, partial squared j plus m squared times omega times the time ordered product of phi 1, phi 2, phi 3, phi 4, omega. Where I've introduced some shorthand notation that I'd like to explain. So first of all, phi 1 of x, phi 1 is equal to phi of x1. And I'll use this notation extensively over the next few lectures. So 1 just indicates the space-time point at which we're evaluating this operator. So this lambda j is equal to minus 1 for a final state and plus 1 for an initial state. And that just comes from the fact that we have an I with no dagger for the final states. And that means, tracing back to where I defined I, that there should be a minus sign in the exponent and a plus 1 for every particle in the initial state. And so this here refers to the partial derivative with respect to x, j. It's not over the four components, so just want to be clear on that. Okay. So this is there are four copies of the Klein-Gordon operator here. So each of these is partial mu. So I haven't written the space-time indices. These are is a particle label. Okay, so this is the key result. So what does it say? So it says if we want to compute these scattering amplitudes, we need to compute time-ordered products of the fields. And so we'll learn how to do that tomorrow. So this is the main ingredient that we don't know how to compute. So here it's just we're basically taking some Fourier transform and some derivative. and we'll see what on Friday or Friday or Tuesday we'll see what this part tells us. But for tomorrow's lecture, at least, we'll focus on computing this part. So this is what we need to compute if we're interested in a scattering amplitude. Okay. And so, as I stated earlier, this works for N to M scattering as well, with the obvious modifications. So if we have N plus N, N particles going to M particles, we need to change the power of I here, change the number of integrals we do here, and change the number of fields we insert here. So I just looked at the example of 2-to-2 scattering as an example. Come back to the question from earlier. But this works for, say, 2-to-3 scattering or three, even with some subtleties, decays of one particle to n particles. OK. So this is our main result, very important result that we'll come back to several times. And I just want to spend some time commenting on the implications of the assumptions we made to derive this formula. So we didn't assume very much, but we did make some assumptions. And so one of the key assumptions we made is that A1 dagger at plus and minus infinity created one particle states. So let's examine that assumption a bit more carefully. So, assumption. A1 dagger of plus and minus infinity is a one particle state. So if this is a one particle state, and we also want to assume that this is a zero particle state. Then it should be true that these states have no overlap. Right. We want to consider these as states with definite particle number. They should have zero overlap. We also assumed that we had the same relationship between A dagger and phi as we did in the free theory. So that also means we also assumed that this is a one particle state. So let's compute omega phi of x omega. Oh, we can't compute it fully, but we can say something about it. So how can we say anything about this? So we know that phi of x is equal to e to the I p dot x, where P is just the total momentum operator from Monday. So times e to the minus I P dot x. Okay, so this acting with e to the I p dot x and e to the minus I p dot x around 5,0 just translate this operator. So if we insert this in here, what we get, this is what we want to compute, what we get is omega 5x omega equals omega e to the I p dot x. It's big P. Let me note the big P is this. Times 5,0 e to the minus I p dot x omega. And we also expect our vacuum state to be Lorentz invariant. So if we translate it, in particular, we expect to get back the same state. So this should be equal to omega phi of 0 omega, since omega is translation invariant. So can we say anything more? Is this equal to 0? There's no particular reason it should be equal to 0. So this could be anything. What we've shown, though, is it's a Lorentz invariant number. Because for any x, we can always, for any x, omega phi of x omega is equal to omega 5,0 omega. So this is Lorentz invariant. So it's not 0, but it is V, and V is Lorentz invariant. So V, it's possible V is 0, but there's nothing that guarantees it. So does that invalidate our whole construction? The answer is fortunately no. But we do need to make some changes to our theory. Yes?
Dan, where have we explicitly used the property that phi of x and phi of k are one particle, I mean, and k of k are one, on vacuum are one particle states?
So, we said that A1 dagger, A2 dagger on omega was a two-particle state. So what we really assumed is that A1 dagger increased the particle number by one. So that in particular implies that A1 dagger on omega should be a one-particle state if omega is a zero-particle state.
What about phi x
in the relation? 5x. So we assumed that we had the same relationship between the creation and annihilation operators, A and A dagger, and phi, as we did in the free theory. So we used that in deriving that useful identity. Well, I didn't show all the steps. You'll show the rest of the steps tomorrow. But that's an assumption that lets you go from the first line on the top board to the second line on the top board. Okay. So I said we can't guarantee this is zero, but that doesn't mean we can't still use our result. And the way we can get around this is if omega phi of x omega equals v, then we can redefine phi tilde to be phi of x minus v, then that means that omega phi tilde of x. Equals zero. So if we shift our field, we can fix this problem. So I'm going to drop the omega, the tildes in what follows. But we can fix this problem by shifting the field. So the key point. Okay. So we're still okay. As long as we shift our fields, we can still use this.
And so shift our creation of rays accordingly.
So this is just a constant.
Right.
So
let's change our creation operators.
I guess we would have to modify those as well. But if we do this and make the other transformation that I'm going to
Describe in a minute, then we'll have the same relations between the
relation operators and phi tilde as we did before. Yes.
Not create a single particle state. Our A daggers, if they do not create something which is a linear combination of the vacuum, then we are fine. It can create something which are two states but with momenta is different from the vacuum.
This is not enough to guarantee that these are one particle states, but this is required. It's necessary but not sufficient. There's another, I'll come to another condition in a few minutes, but. Thanks for pointing that out. Okay. So in tutorial this morning, you calculated the form factor for a free theory. And what you found is that K phi of x omega is equal to e to the I k dot x. And so what you used here in deriving this was basically the relationship between phi and a. And you also used the fact basically that the a dagger created a one particle state. So this we'd like this also to hold in our interacting theory. So let's see about what we can say about this quantity in the interacting theory. So making the same kind of argument as before, we compute k phi of x omega. This is just k e to the I p dot x, phi of 0, e to the minus I, p dot x, omega. So the vacuum is translation invariant. And k is an eigenstate of momentum operator. So this is equal to e to the I, k dot x times k phi of 0 omega. So this is the factor we want. We'd like this to be 1. We can't say anything more about this in general. It may or may not be 1. We can say it's Lorentz invariant, though, because for any x, we get the same answer. So this is some Lorentz invariant number. But as we did before, we can redefine our field to make that quantity 1. And we can do that just by rescaling the field. So let's suppose this is equal to 1 over n. Then if we define phi tilde of x to be equal to n times phi of x, then k phi of 0 tilde omega equals 1. And so if we rescale it, we're still OK. Our interpretation of the A1 daggers as creating one particle states is still fine.
This one?
Yeah.
Here?
Yeah. Okay, so this is equal to omega by the same reasoning as before. K is a momentum eigenstate. So, and the eigenvalue, so the eigenvalue of K, if we act with P on it, is just K. And so if we act with e to the I P dot x, we'll just get e to the I K dot x. Tom.
Oh, no, it's just practically from the senses multiplying 0 by x.
So we need to both shift our field and rescale it. But we can do those separately. Okay. So there was a question before about how this is not enough to ensure that these are one particle states. We need our one particle states not only to be orthogonal to the zero particle states, they should also be orthogonal to the multiparticle states. And in the interest of time, I'm not going to go through that in class, but I just want to say a few things about it, but I've got much more details in the lecture notes that I posted on the wiki. So if you're interested in how do we know that psi A1 dagger of T acting on omega is 0, so that where this is a normalizable n particle state, there are details in the lecture notes, but you just need to make two assumptions here. So you need to assume that this is normalizable and that there are no bound states. So without needing to change anything about the field, we don't need to do any more redefinitions. It's guaranteed that our one particle states will be orthogonal to the multiparticle states. And I won't go into any of the math, but a physical reason for why this is true is, so this is, sorry, this should be plus or minus infinity here. Is that multi-particle states spread out differently from single particle states, as long as there's no bound states. So if we have, say, a one particle state that has total momentum k that's localized near the origin. And we have a two particle state that is also localized near the origin as the same total momentum. That's the only case you really should be worried about here is if the total momentum is the same, then you might worry they spread out. Even though both spread out, they spread out in the same way, so the overlap doesn't go to zero. But unless the two particles stay close to each other, and have no relative momentum, in which case they form a bound state, then the two particles will also spread out relative to each other. And so they should, even though there might be an overlap between the center of mass of the two particles and the one particle state, there's not going to be any overlap between where the two particles are at large times and where the one particle is. So that's a sort of hand-waving explanation, but there's more details if you're interested in the lecture notes. Yes?
Could we also act with the number operator on this state to check that it's a one particle state?
If we knew if we have a particular theory, we could do that. In order to, so I haven't made any assumptions about the form of the interactions. If we, for a particular theory, we could do that, but I'm not aware of.
I thought it was in terms of A's and A daggers. So you're saying it would change because of the interaction.
Is that right? Let me think about that. I'm not sure, certain whether that would work or not. So what are the implications of what we've seen here? So we've calculated a formula that allows us to compute the scattering amplitude without a lot of inputs. We just needed to think a bit about what we meant by a one-particle state, a zero-particle state, and an n-particle state, and make some analogies with the free theory. And we came up with two conditions. That we had to satisfy in order to make our assumptions that we used to derive that formula valid. And we had to shift and rescale our field in order to satisfy those assumptions. So let's look at an example. Suppose our original theory is, suppose we're interested in studying the theory. The phi cube theory. So we can use the LSE reduction formula if we shift and rescale. And rename. And if we do that, starting with this theory, so I'll call this L naive, so we can't use the LSE reduction formula here, we get the L where LSE is valid. That takes the form, we get extra factors in front of all of the terms here, which I'll call Z. So we get an overall factor here, another factor here, Zg. And from shifting, we don't get any new terms from these, but we'll get a new term from this. So if we shift this, we'll also get a linear term. This is a new term. And these are new factors. So this is a reasonable theory to study. This one, we are generally not justified in using that. We're going to, so this is one reason why we might need to renormalize our theory so we can if we start with this theory, add up a term that perturbs our free theory, so this is our free Lagrangian here, we have to add some, maybe change our coefficients and perhaps add additional terms in order for the theory to still make sense. Sorry? So, well, there are conditions on these factors z and y in order, if we want to satisfy those. We'll come back to that next week. But for now, for some choice of z's and y's, we can satisfy our two conditions. Yes?
Is it obvious that the first Lagrangian is not possible to apply the LHC formula to?
So to be careful about what, so yeah, there's no, it's not obvious immediately that LHC doesn't work here. But if we try to compute, say, this quantity or omega phi of x omega, which we'll learn how to do later, we'll find that it's not possible in general for this theory. Yes.
I guess this theory doesn't really have any symmetries, but if it did,
would
this
shifting ruin some of the symmetries? It's, if you shift the theory, yet, so it's possible it could ruin some of the symmetries. Okay. So this is the proper way to do things. We're basically, at least for the next three or four lectures, ignore this problem and do something that is not justified but won't actually cause us any problems until, well, we're just dealing with the tree level theory. And we're going to set the z is equal to 1 and y equal to 0. We're going to study this theory and other theories where we might get different factors z and some additional terms y, and we're just going to ignore all of them for now. This is not generally valid. A valid thing to do, but I'll restore them and talk about when it is valid next Wednesday, I think. So, yes? So if we compute in this theory, we can compute omega phi of 0, phi of x omega. And this is not equal to 0 if we use this, for example.
So we are going to use, I mean, you set the z is all. You're saying we're going to use it anyway for now, right?
For now, yes. But this is a problem with what we're doing that we'll come back to, and you should keep in the back of your mind.
So are you saying that at the tree level it's not a problem?
That's right.
Then we go to loops, then you have to.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This is okay. So the way we so these can be determined. Well, you can determine some constraints on these at least by enforcing these conditions, and the way you generally do that is perturbatively, in say the coupling constant. And these are the leading order results. So in this theory, this would be 1 plus order g squared, and this is plus order g. So if we, I haven't explained how we're going to do the perturbation theory, but when we do perturbation theory, as long as we're at low enough order, namely at tree level, instead of loop level, then it's OK to ignore these terms.
Yes. Earlier you said that the states evolve according to the Schrodinger equation. In the Schrodinger picture.
Okay.
But I don't see where the Schrodinger equation comes in here. So we're in the Heisenberg picture, right?
We're in the Heisenberg picture.
The operators evolve, but they evolve according to the Klein-Gordon.
So our free theory was the Klein-Gordon theory. Mm-hmm. Now we're interested in
taking our Klein-Gordon theory, which is, say, the first two terms here, and adding an extra term here. So if we add an extra term, the equation satisfied by this, the classical equation satisfied by this field will be modified from the Klein-Gordon equation. We'll get an extra term. And from now on, we'll be interested in Lagrangians that are the Klein-Gordon Lagrangian plus an additional perturbation term. And we'll, starting tomorrow, we'll talk about how to think about these extra terms as perturbations to our original free theory that we understand from yesterday.
Yes?
Why did we choose the perturbation to be cubic? Could we have any function of pi there?
This is just an example. We'll look at several different examples over the next few lectures. Any other questions? Yes.
Does the zero state still have an interpretation in interacting theory? The old vacuum.
The old vacuum. So we'll see how to relate tomorrow the zero and omega. So I'll write down a formula that relates them. Yeah.
The zero state must still be the single particle vacuum.
It's the zero state is the vacuum of the free theory.
Yeah, I mean, when the particles are like far, far separated, then you can write their vacuum
as zero. Let's come back to that tomorrow. All right, I'll see you tomorrow.